all the attendees and to Professor R.K. Shyamsundar, who has joined with us today to deliver his talk in this third day of the Science Academy's online workshop. And he'll be talking to us about electronic cash, cryptocurrencies, and smart contracts. As a customary, I'll introduce Professor Shyamsundar, who started the Theoretical Computer Science Group at TIFR, covering areas of concurrency, real-time programming, specification and verification of the software. He was the first dean of the School of Technology and Computer Science at TIFR and has held various assignments at IBM T.J. Watson Research Center and Owen University of Technology, Pennsylvania State University, University of Illinois, University of California, and so on. He made outstanding contributions in the areas of real-time distributed system, programming languages, logic programming, reactive systems, and formal methods. His work on semantics of real-time distributed programs was the first that provided realistic parameterized models for real-time distributed models having ADA-like rendezvous mechanisms. He was elected Fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, National Academy of Sciences, India, Allahabad, Indian National Academy of Engineering and the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, that is IEEE, Fellow of ACM, Fellow of TWAS, and has also received the S.N. Mitra Award for Excellence in Engineering Sciences from INAE, that is Indian National Academy of Engineering. And apart from that, he's also a Fellow of IET and a Diamond Jubilee Medal. With these words, I request Professor Shyamsundar to kindly deliver his talk on digital cash, cryptocurrencies, and smart contracts. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Manoj, for a nice introduction and for the opportunity. And let me go through in the next 45 to 50 minutes the challenges that exist in the electronic cash, cryptocurrencies, and smart contracts. Of course, this is a large topic, but I want to convey the essence of the things and convince you the challenges before the young community and why they are, and rather than going into detail on each and everything, I will also try to give a little background so that it becomes easy for people to recollect some of the definitions, what they may have forgotten, kind of a framework idea. So let me start. So now this is the rough organization, digital cash. Of course, as you see that Digital India, the challenge is how all the paper things can be translated into electronics. And that is how I will illustrate, starting from digital cash that resulted in the Bitcoin and the cryptocurrencies. And I will try to highlight what is the story behind that, and the technology and the mathematics, little bit of mathematics behind that kind of a thing. So everyone knows you had early forms of currency, like a receipt for grain storage, which is found in Mesopotamia. In the Bronze Age, ingots were used for trade. And currency took off only when coinage was introduced in the Iron Age. For example, Marco Polo, when he returned from the Far East, with the descriptions of exotic currencies such as banknotes, salt, and cowrie shells. And the limited economies also were related to tobacco, rice, pelts, and so on and so forth. And of course, recently, maybe in the latter half of 18th century, the Western Union and started technically, in some sense, the dematerialization of the money. Because when the East Coast and the West Coast of US was connected, which happened in 1861, then by 1971, money transfer was possible over all its lines. It may be a typing mistake. So first step, this was in the 1871, money transfer over all its lines. And this was the first step of the virtualization of the money. So now if you look, go back to Aristotle, from the 350 BC, it must provide a sound money, an intrinsic value. So value must be contained in the money itself. Like if you see, even in the currency notes given by the 1 rupee note, which says that it has its value, and then the other ones are all from the RBI kind of a thing. Some of the properties what one would like to have in the sound money is recognizable. That means that it is easy to recognize and verify the authenticity. If I show you this is a 100 rupee note from India, you should be able to recognize without taking much time looking at it carefully, like what they do in the bank. Even though they recognize, they do it for different purposes. Transferable, easy to transfer ownership from one person to another. That is, A can give to B, B can give to C, and so on and so forth. And divisible, it can always be divided 1 rupee, 100 rupees, 50 rupees, 20 rupees, and so on and so forth. Naturally, it has to be limited quantity. Then it, otherwise it becomes almost like everyone can create money, and so then it will not have any value itself kind of a thing. But durable, it must be physically stable, doesn't rot or rust or melt. And so that's how you see that why the paper for the currency notes are so costly, and then it is not cheap kind of a framework or the other. Fungible, that means that the units could be replaced by some other currency or another asset, and all that kind of a framework or the other. So now let us take a small digital cash structure. Let us say there is a bank. It issues a digital cash to a person A. And then the person A can send the digital cash to person B. And then the person B, now having received that, he can submit it to the bank to get the payment. So what is the thing here? What you would see is that, is there a difference between a check or a cash? Technically, there is no difference between a check and a cash. So now that is where you would see that much of the things what exist in check or cash is the something or the other. You will see what is the thing that could be done, what kind of digital cash can be constructed, and what would be the mathematics needed, and what is the technology kind of a framework or the other. So now in the digital cash, the use of digital cash is not dependent on any physical location. See, that is one aspect you can look at it, and can be transferred between the physical world and the virtual world. So now that is means that is one of the good things of the digital cash. So if you had forgotten, everything is on online, so you can do that. Again, the properties are, it should be secure, obviously unforgeable, anonymous. That means that if A gives it to B, B, there should be no way to say that this is the currency that was given by A to B. That is where I think whole anonymity and privacy works in the classic society. Portable, it is not dependent on any physical location. Two-way, that means A can give it to B and B can give it to C. And offline capable. What does that mean? I don't have to check very carefully whether this is exactly the same cash, whether it is a cash on which I would get the cash or not, whether it is forged kind of a framework without being online. That means that because internet, as you know, it is always failure is a common feature or a characteristic of the internet. So that means that if you are offline for a time, then can one cheat? That would be the question that comes into the picture, what you would have seen in the phishing and so on and so forth. And now it should be offline capable and wider acceptability. That is one of the most important things in the digitization. People should accept. And for people to accept, it has to be user friendly. If it requires a lot of efforts, there's no point, because people will not use it kind of a framework. Because many of you, for example, if you are doing a virus scanner, it is taking time. You will switch off the virus scanner because you are in an urgent mode, even though it may have its own issues kind of a framework. So now let us see what are the categories of the digital cash. One is important. It has to be anonymous or identified. If it is identified, it loses its picture. It technically becomes technically like a check. Because check, it has to be deposited in the bank and you will be identified. So whereas anonymous means it remains close to cash what we use. And the other one is the online or the offline. Online essentially amounts to saying that the internet has to be available and you can check whether it is a money that has already been spent or it has not been spent. So I will get the money, what was tendered kind of a framework. Offline means that even if the internet is not there, I should be able to realize the proceeds of the cash what I have given and I should be able to use it. And the third category is, of course, people have used like credit cards. You have smart cards or pure electronic cards. You can put this much cash is there and then you can use it kind of a framework. So what we would be interested, first I will try to highlight the how we can construct an online and an offline. And then we will see how that remained one of the characteristics that was not satisfied from the properties of the money led to the Bitcoin kind of a framework or the other. So before I go, let me just give you a very brief background so that if some of the keywords you will become familiar and you can recollect it kind of a framework or the other. First, of course, the symmetric key cryptography, where you have the encryption and the decryption keys are the same. So if you want to encrypt, like Alice wants to encrypt, he takes the key, she takes the key, encrypts it and sends it over the channel, and then the Bob can decrypt it using the same key. So that means the keys are exactly the same. So now you have the asymmetric key cryptography, that is Diffie and Hellman in 1976. Propose the use of different keys for encryption and decryption. That means you have one key for encryption and another key for decryption kind of a framework. And here is the channel which is being sent. Somebody can eavesdrop based upon what it is, a kind of a framework, whether you can break it, et cetera, kind of a framework. So now you have the public key cryptography is a part of a symmetric, your asymmetric key. The difference is you have the encryption key is public. That means it is not between two. Anyone can use that as a public key. And then you have a secret decryption key. So if somebody says, if it is for the ministers, you have this public key encryption key and you can use that to encrypt it, or you can encrypt it using that key and send it to him kind of a framework or the other. So this key and this key are different. This is public, that means everything is open. Anyone knows it if you search it and you will get it. And the other one is a secret decryption key. For whatever reasons it was, when the RSA was given, that is the Ribes Shamir Adelman's algorithm, it was called private. Private and secret are different. I will not go into the details. Secret means it should not be given to anyone at all kind of a framework or the other. So now here, the foundations on which these mathematics is, these are built on some kind of a mathematical function. One is the one-way function. A one-way function is a function that is easy to compute, but computationally hard to reverse. That means you can, given x, you can compute f of x, but it is hard, difficult to get x if you are given f of x kind of a framework. And so you have one-way function candidate, which are modular exponentiation and so on and so forth. I will not go into those aspects at all kind of a framework. And then you have little more thing, what is essentially used in all these many cryptographies, trapdoor one-way function. A trapdoor one-way function is a function, again, similar to one-way function, easy to compute, but computationally hard to reverse. Easy to calculate f of x given x, and similarly inversion becomes difficult, has one more property, with certain knowledge is easy to invert. So that is where the difference comes into the picture, and the other proofs are all you don't have to worry about as far as this talk is concerned, kind of a framework. And again, you have trapdoor one-way function, which are the candidates, etc. So now one of the, as I already mentioned, the public key cryptography, if you take the Diffie-Hellman, you have the decryption, encryption, and of P, and you will get back the P, that is nothing has been changed kind of a framework or the other. So now let us assume you have the, I'm just illustrating, public key cryptography, if you say E of KU is the encryption using the public key KU. That means U indicates it is public, and KR indicates it is private or secret kind of a framework. Now, if you are given a plain text, now if you encrypt it using the public key, and then if you you can decrypt it using the secret key, and you will get back P for yourself. So now, a sense of the public key systems, knowing somebody's public key does not help you to find their private key, because it is completely private. And now the public key is published. Everyone on the net can find out what is your public key. Encryption algorithm is also public. Only owners know the secret key, and difficulty lies in finding algorithms that satisfy the Diffie-Hellman criteria. One of the things was RSA kind of a framework or the other. And this is based upon the dividing the plain text into blocks of k bits, where k is the largest integer for which n is greater than 2 power k, and p has a binary value which has less than n. Encryption is given by c is equal to p to the power of p modulo n, and decryption is then given by p c to the power of d and then mod n, and now you can say it is the same as if you take p of e d mod n kind of a framework idea. So the RSA algorithm is based on some principles from the number theory. And suppose you have P and Q are large numbers, greater than 10 to the power of 100, and N equal to P by Q, and then Z equal to P minus 1 into Q minus 1. K is approximately about 664 bits or 80 bytes, and D is relatively prime to Z. E is such that E multiplied by D equal to 1 mod Z. That means it is relative. In practice, RSA is very slow, often used only for key distribution kind of a framework. So what does one do? To encrypt, one needs E and N, that is the public key of the receiver. For decryption, one needs the private key of the receiver. And then the security of this method is based on difficulty of factoring the large numbers. If N is public, but P and Q are hard to find, and factoring a 200-digit number needs about 4 billion years of computer time kind of a framework. I will not go into this. And now you see that how one can achieve the authentication. Authentication means that it must have come from the minister's office. Let us say I have to be sure that a document has come from that. Now, what is the one? Now, here is the sender. You have a plain text. You have the sender's private key, you encrypt it, encrypted text comes, and now the encrypted text gets decrypted using the sender's public key, and now the receiver, now that means it must have come from this that person, and but there is no confidentiality because it is public, because you have the public key, anyone can decrypt it and see whatever it is. It is just like a notice board if I want to put it, now everyone knows I can decrypt it kind of a framework. The reverse way is confidentiality, but no authentication. So now the sender in the plain text, you uses the receiver's public key. I want to send it to him. I will use his public key and then encrypt it and send it to him. And now the receiver has to use his private key. Nobody else has the private key. And so it is confidential kind of a framework or the other. So now authentication and confidentiality is achieved using this kind of a framework or the other. That means these two approaches can be combined for both confidentiality and authentication. Sender encrypts the message with his or her private key for authentication, and the resulting ciphertext is encrypted again using the receiver's public key for confidentiality. Receiver first decrypts with private key and then decrypts with the sender's private key kind of a framework. So now with this as the background, let us move an online digital cache, how we can construct a system for that kind of a framework. So here you have to have bank. Let us say instead of currency, we'll call that as coins, and he want to withdraw some coins from the user, or he can deposit the coins and the user can pay it to the merchant, and the merchant can give a receipt that I have received this much payment, and then he can deposit the coins and get the results kind of a framework or the other, and link to the other banks kind of a framework. So now our main thing is it has to be untraceable, but it is online. That means that Only if you are sure that there is an internet online 24/7, you will not be sure of whatever it is. As usual, you can assume that it has the same structure of a currency note with serial number, signatures, etc., etc., pictures, and all that things. What is the thing that becomes very difficult in the digital world is copying comes for free. If A gives, let us say, 100 rupee in the digital cash to B, and he still has the same copy. In the physical world, if I give my 100 rupees, I don't have that 100 rupees, so I cannot use it. So now assuming forging is difficult, so double spending in some sense is not possible because of the mutual exclusion. But in the digital world, copying is for free. So that means that I will have an umpteen number of copies by having 100 rupees, and now that I can go on sending it to so many people or the other. So now how do we construct this kind of a framework? Because the important thing, if the cash has to be acceptable by the society, it is important anonymity has to be achieved, kind of a framework or the other. It is for this purpose, what was used by David Shaum as what is called the blinding, using the hat signatures, using the mathematical background, what I suggested. So now here, what is the thing that has been, then I will describe a online e-cash scheme. Now I can create an RSA signature from the bank that could not be for that, but one which the bank will not recognize as to from whom it came from. To give you a very practical way of looking at it, suppose you go to the bank and then you say that I want to get 100 rupee digital cash. And now let us say, assume you have several envelopes that have been signed by the bank. They ask you, you pick anyone. So now the bank does not know, assume that whatever is contained is exactly the same thing or the other. Now if you take that, now you are sure that it is the bank and I don't have any problems with that. But the bank also will not know this is the cash I have given. And if I cash, I give it to somebody and now he can open it up and give it in the bank because it has been signed by the bank, there is no problem kind of a framework. This kind of a thing has to be achieved in a mathematics in the electronic form is the basic criterion for realizing the online e-cash. So, for example, let us assume the structure of a money is in some sense of the form x, f of x to the power of 1 upon 3 modulo n, where n is the public modulus and f and g are the one-way functions as I described earlier. And also it should be infeasible to come up with the different y and z such that f of y is equal to f of z, so no collision, etc. kind of a framework. There are many examples like MD4, MD5. I will not go into the detail because that is not important as far as the talk is concerned kind of thing. So now, what does that mean? The only bank can find the cube root of modulo n. So f of x is used so that forging is not possible because the denotation has f of x to the power of 1 upon 3, f of x to the power of 1 upon 3 can be taken only by the bank. I cannot take it, but I can compute f of x. So now in some sense, if I am able to get y cube comma y structure, it leads to a valid money, which is of the same form of x comma f of x to the power of 1 upon 3. And so leads to valid money, even though cube root was not taken. It's only the bank that means can create money, so no forging, and so a bank is a trusted party, and so there is no problem. So now this is the way you are going to achieve the blinding. Bank signs the value without knowing what value it is signing, and you what is the way it works? You can choose an x, find f of x, because f is a one-way function, you can compute f of x easily, and now choose a random number r and send f of x multiplied by r to the power of 3 to the bank, all are modulo n, and bank takes the cube root, and then it gets technically r multiplied by f of x to the power of 1 upon 3, and thus the bank does not see either r, which is the random number which is chosen by the user, or f of x to the power of 1 upon 3 separately, but can see only their product. So that means that now, if the bank sends R multiplied by f of x to the power of 1 upon 3 back to the user, and user has R, he can divide it by R, and so he gets f of x to the power of 1 upon 3. He knows x, and so he gets the denotation of the currency x comma f of x to the power of 1 upon 3. So that means whatever he has taken, and that is what he would have got it, and the person has the money that could only have been signed by the bank. Yet the bank won't recognize it when it is deposited because there is no other information associated with it kind of a framework. You can have other routine aspects need to be taken care of, etc. kind of a framework. How is it online? That means that when I'm going to have check, when the person gets it, he deposits in the bank. It is not like it cannot go from peer to peer. A gets B, B will not be able to send it to C, B has to deposit in the bank and then get it. Now, immediately he sends it in the bank. The bank sees whether this money has already been spent or not because it is online. If it is not spent already, then he gets the money. Otherwise, immediately he gets a note saying that it is not valid. So now if you go back to the flow chart, now the merchant, when the user pays the merchant, he checks it with the bank and then he would have got the money and then only he will get the receipt. If he does not get the result is no, then he will not get a receipt and the whole thing gets a denied kind of a framework or the other. So now this is the way the whole online cash works kind of a framework or the other. But what is the pros and cons of this online cash? Let us see. Provides a fully anonymous and untraceable digital cash. User ID will not be revealed in any way. That is what we want because privacy is important for cash. And no double spending problems because immediately you are going to say whether this one is used or not. And checked in real time during the transaction. And there is no need of an additional hardware. Existing the point of sale devices would be used with a software update as appropriate as usual for any digital system. What are the cons? Communication overhead between merchant and the bank, because immediately he has to be, you cannot delay it, otherwise the whole process will not be going through. And now that means that the bank also should have a huge database of coin records and difficult to scale, because that means whenever there is a large amount of data that has to be stored and accessed and communication, the scaling becomes a problem and then need synchronization between bank servers. And that's how, and the other most disadvantage is the coins are not reusable. You have to deposit in the bank and then only you get fresh coins and give it to the others kind of a framework or the other. So now let us see how we can modify to an offline cache. What does that offline cache essentially mean? I have to still preserve the anonymity, but the chances of this being double spent should be very small. So that is the basic criterion. So you will always have small problems or the other associated, just like what you are seeing. For example, when you have got some 500 rupees in a shop and then you go and give it in a bank, the bank guy sees it in some ultraviolet or some machine and sees whether it is forged or unforged. For some reason, there is a small probability it may be a forged one and counterfeit note kind of a frame. Similar to that, we should have a small probability that it could be a double spending kind of a framework or the other. So the structure is almost the same, but there is a difference because the only thing what we say is that only when the person tries to double spend, then only his information has to be revealed. Till that time, it remains anonymous. Only when he tries to spend it again, then only his information has to be revealed kind of a thing. So the cash is almost the same, except structurally small changes. Instead of one parameter and then it's a two argument one way function, it's a product of k by two numbers. You will understand what is k, but because that is a security parameter that affects the chance of a cheater getting away with it. Each number is of the form f of xi comma yi to the power of 1 upon 3, as I mentioned, f is a two-argument one-way function. And now, the structure of xi is of the form x of I equal to g of ai comma ci, where ai and ci are random and g is one-way. And similarly, yi is g of ai exclusive r, which is indicated by xr, of information. It may be his information, cell number, address, etc. kind of a framework, a comma di, where di is another random number and information identifies the person's account number and how I can trace him kind of a framework or di. So now here in the offline cache, what happens? So now xi is of the form g of ai comma ci, and yi is of the form g of ai exclusive or of information comma d of I kind of a thing. Now if one can find ai and ai xr information, that is two times when he copies to gives it to b as well as c, a gives it to b and c, then if it is possible in one I can find both ai and ai xr. Now if I did that, AI gets cancelled, the information gets leaked out, and I will be able to say that this is the person who is trying to double spend, and then he can be penalized kind of a framework. Using this simple technology, you will be able to say what is the thing are there. So now, for example, here, now if you see the customer, when he sends it to the vendor, he gives the money. This is where the k by 2 comes into the picture. So randomly, for the size of the vector, you choose 0, 1, or etc. kind of a framework. When you have 1, it means this is the AI. When it is 0, it means it is AI XR information kind of a framework. So this goes to the vendor. And now if customer gives it to the vendor, the same money, and the vendor too, it gives it when it comes to the bank. And now there is a probability that all of them will be exactly the same is small. That is where the n parameter comes into the picture, or k into the picture. When if this one is submitted, now here you see that here you get a AI, and here you have AI exclusive R information. Because I know AI and AI XR information, now if I do AI gets knocked out and I get the information, so the account name is revealed to the person kind of a framework. So this is a nice scheme which is called the blinding, again due to David Shaw. And on this, lots of work got done, and almost it became a digital cash was to be issued, and for some reason it got delayed till Bitcoin kind of a framework or the other. So now one may wonder, is there a difficulty in this kind of a people can do something or the other? The problem is that if somebody else behaves as if, like in a fish, this one, I am the same customer, he can use that and send it to the vendor too, as if the customer had sent it. Like what you see, that I can mimic a customer himself and send it to him. Then customer will be caught. And so these are all problems that would be associated, how you have to handle it, kind of a framework. So now, just to have a probability of catching a user, as I mentioned, it depends upon the number of identity pairs that are used in the transaction. The more pairs used, the greater the chance of catching the culprit, and the probability of catching the culprit is 1 minus 1 over 2 to the power of k, where k is the number of pairs that is used. For example, if you have n equal to 5, and now the probability will be 0.96875, and so if you increase k, and then the probability increases. So now, what is the main limitation? It cannot be doing from peer to peer like the classical currency, while it satisfies most of the properties what we are demanding. And so that is where it important lot of research got into developing how one can do so that direct transfer from, like in a cash, if A gets B, A sends it to B, B can send it to C, and so on and so forth, kind of a framework or the other. That is, in some sense, the rationale in which the bitcoins or the cryptocurrencies, that is how it is called, the original paper by Nakamoto is called peer-to-peer electronic cash system, kind of a framework or the other. And so just to give bitcoins, you have identities and signatures, as I already explained in the RSA, and it has a ledger. the balance of each identity which is saved in some kind of a data structure which is called blockchain. This data structure name was not part and parcel of the Bitcoin proposal. And transactions is essentially I can move Bitcoins from one identity to another. There is a serialized transaction backed by a transaction log, and log is persistent and log is immutable or temporary. So let me just give you, just you don't have to read this ledger. This is a ledger. So now assume you have 100 persons, they are transacting across the banks. Now each bank has the complete ledger. What are the transactions that are taking place across these 100 persons? And each of them has a copy. But publicly, one can verify this money, whether from where it has traced. When if I have got 100 rupees, now I can trace from where it has come, from the origin, how many hands it has changed, etc. kind of a framework. And that is the basis in which it is also called the distributed ledger, a technology kind of a framework or the other. So as I mentioned, the classic thing is the digital signatures, as we used for, it is used for authentication and not for privacy kind of a framework. Now, if you come to the digital signatures and the Bitcoin, Bitcoin is a chain of digital signatures. Coin owners digitally sign their coin to transfer them to other recipients, and Alice wants to move a Bitcoin to Bob. So, for example, now this Bitcoin, Alice wants to move to a Bitcoin to Bob, and so now here you have, this is the Bitcoin that is won. Now you have the Alice signature. Now this becomes a signature of Alice and Bob kind of a framework. Now I can verify whether it's indeed the signature, because the public keys are public. So using that, I can say whether it's a valid signature or whether it is not a valid signature kind of a framework or the other, this one. So now here, so in the, if you look at the digital signatures and the Bitcoin, now if Bob wants to move his coins to Diana, now that means that you have the signature of Alice and Bob, and now here you have the public key of Diana, and now here you have the secret key of Bob, and now using this you create the signature, and signature Bob Diana comes into the picture. And so now here, this is the combination, what it would be like. You have a signature of an Alice, you have a public key of Bob, and now what is this function it would look like? You will see in the next one, it is just like the SHA-256 kind of a framework. Like you see that you have the signature Alice Bob and PK Diana, and now here you have the signature concatenated and using the public key of Diana. Using this, I can create a 256-bit unique string kind of a framework. For example, if I take ABC, you will have this. And now if I change one of them to a capital C, you will have a different thing or the other. So in some sense, you have, this is the SHA is the one which comes into the picture kind of a framework. Now the question is that, is it possible, how have we are going to avoid the double spending in this structure, and how do we prevent it is the question that comes into the picture here. How is double spending, and how can it be prevented kind of a framework or the other? And so now here you see that spending the same digital cash asset more than once, as you know, is essentially the feature of the double spending, which is obviously, as I already discussed, in physical cash is not possible because of the mutual exclusion, and prevented in traditional banking system through concurrency control kind of a framework. Now, if you want to prevent it, now if I have to give it to the trusted bank, it is the same old story of a trusted bank, because I have to trust somebody kind of a framework. The idea of a Bitcoin is I should not trust anyone at all kind of a framework or the other. And so now the double spending prevention, as I mentioned, give you the notion of the ledger. A network of nodes, which is given here, nodes maintains a ledger. Network of nodes work to agree on transactions order. What is the order in which the transaction have happened? Like in a ledger, because it will be time order. Serializing transactions on every coin prevents the double spending. That means that I have to have a serialized, that is where the notion of a blockchain, which is a linear thing, comes into the picture. Now the question is, what is the ledger? And how do we agree on the transaction order? And what incentive the network nodes to maintain the ledger? In this figure, what is it? You have the Bitcoin. Each one there is no difference. There is nothing like you are a owner, you have priority kind of a framework or the other. Everyone can participate in an equal footing kind of a framework. It's a democracy, like a voting kind of a framework that comes into the picture in this structure. So now here, the transactions, for example, let us say in the first 10 minutes, these are all transactions, like in a ledger, what I said in a bank, one bank, 2 hour, time one, all these are valid, and all these are valid, all these are valid, and these are all chained. Now, if this is the current time, this is a link to this, this is linked to this, this is linked to this, this is linked to this. Now, if I want to identify whether this is correct, this becomes a directed graph. I can see if this was the initial coin, how does it catch well kind of a framework or the other by using the classic send receive, almost like a Kirchhoff law kind of a framework, in and out balancing kind of a framework or the other. So now, where is the ledger stored? Each network node, like what neat means that all these are keeping a copy of the node. There is nothing like there is a legitimate person who keeps it or kind of a framework. Everyone has. Each network node maintains its copy of the ledger. And now the question is that, if that is the one, somebody can replace either this whole transaction or I can replace it by hash kind of a framework. But here the blocks are connected through the hash pointers. You take a hash and then you're pointing to the previous one. Each block contains the hash of the previous block. And this hash gives each block its location in the blockchain. So tampering with the content of any block can easily be detected. So that means content of any block, if there is a hash difference, then it becomes different. Then I can replace the whole next chain kind of a framework. So that means that this, by just checking one transaction block, is not good enough. I have to be sure about what happens for the whole chain, because this is the origin. If I have got 100 rupees from C, I have to see how he got it, how this one got, how he got, and this is the genesis, that means in the beginning kind of a framework earlier. So now, how is the ledger tamper free? Blocks are connected through hash pointers. Each block contains the hash of the previous block. This hash gives each block its location in the blockchain. Tampering the content of any block can easily be detected. Replacing a consistent blockchain with another tampered blockchain chain should be made hard. That means you cannot replace the whole chain itself, kind of a framework should be made very hard. And that is the one that means that I should be able to check either this is consistent or this hash is consistent kind of a framework. Whereas now, if I'm going to say all these kind of a framework are the other. So now you have a big picture, you have a network nodes, which is the big picture. And now how is it done? This ledger is fully replicated all the network nodes. To make progress, network nodes group new transactions into a block. Blocks are fixed in size, like 1 megabyte. Network nodes validate new transactions to make sure that transactions on the new block do not conflict with each other. And so transactions on the new block do not conflict with the previous block transaction. That means that all the way up to the genesis, you have to make sure how there is no conflict and they are in full agreement with the other. Network nodes need to agree on the next block. That means that if I'm able to do that, at any point, which is the one who can add in a linear way to the blockchain, and that is where the notion of consensus. Consensus means all the nodes have to agree that this is the person A will add, and for that I have to arrange for some kind of a competition. As far as possible, it should be such that I will get only one unique person kind of a framework or the other. And so now Nakamoto's consensus, intuitively network nodes race to solve a puzzle. This puzzle is computationally very expensive. Once a network node finds, that is called the mine, a solution, it adds a block of transaction to the blockchain. It multicast the solution to the other network nodes, and other network nodes accept and verify a solution kind of a framework. Just to give you the, usually it also has the timestamp, so that it gives you a timestamp server, works by taking the hash of block of items to be timestamped and widely publishing the hash, such as the newspaper or the Usenet. The timestamp proves that the data must have existed at the time, obviously, in order to get into the hash. Each timestamp includes the previous timestamp in its hash, forming a chain with each additional timestamp, reinforcing the ones before it, kind of a framework or the other. So as I mentioned, the proof of work involves scanning a value for a value that when hashed, such as using, as I mentioned, I described the SHA-256, the hash begins with a number of zero bits. Like if you have seen here, here if you see here nonce, that is a thing which is not seen before. This is the fresh one. Similarly, this is the fresh one. Now I say if I take the hash of this, it should have that many zeros, kind of a framework or the other. Then there is no other way other than going on increasing one by one. So it becomes heavy computation, kind of a framework or the other. This is called the proof of work. And for the timestamp network, you implement the proof of work. That is every block, every time you say that this is the number of zeros one has to find. Whoever finds it, you are the ones. Whoever finds it, he's the person who will be able to add the blocks, a kind of a framework. As I mentioned, the others won't accept if the block itself has invalid transactions, kind of a framework or the other. And so now the proof of work solves the problem of determining representation in majority decision making, kind of a framework. And if the majority were based on one IP address, one vote, you can go on giving many IPs. But the POW is essentially one CPU, one vote. That means that the more computing power you have, you will be able to compute quickly, kind of a framework. The majority decision is represented by the longest chain, which has the greatest proof of work effort invested in it. If a majority of the CPU power is controlled by honest nodes, the honest chain will grow the fastest and outspace any competing chain. And this gives so that essentially means to modify the past block, an attacker would have to redo the whole proof of work, which is very costly, and all blocks after it, and then catch up with the surpass the work of the honest nodes, which becomes difficult. The probability of a slower attacker catching up diminishes exponentially as subsequent blocks are added, kind of a framework. So now here, if you see the difficulty, adjust difficulty every 2016 blocks. Expected minutes to mine 10 minutes per block. Actual time will be timestamp of the block 2016 minus timestamp of block 1. New difficulty, you will say what is the expected over actual, kind of a framework or the other. So now what is the structure? New transactions are broadcast to all nodes. Each node collects new transactions into a block. Each node works on finding a difficult POW for its block. When a node finds a POW, it broadcasts the block to all the nodes, and nodes accept the block only if all transactions in it are valid and not already spent. Nodes express their acceptance of the block by working on creating the next block in the chain using the hash of the accepted block as the previous hash. So now here, why the hell somebody node who is not getting should work for this? Now here, that is where they have introduced some notion of incentives. He will get some bitcoins, kind of a framework or the other, and that is the incentive. Whoever wins the puzzle, he gets some bitcoins, and so it will be added to his structure, and that is how it becomes. I will not go into the details, kind of a framework, for lack of time. If you look at the mining in the big picture, you have so many nodes which are spread out across the world, kind of a framework. Of course, lot of things all exist in China as well, kind of a framework or the other. So find a nonce that results in the SHA, which is less than difficulty. The solution space is a set. Once a solution is found, a block is mined, easily verified by network nodes. It cannot be pre-computed, cannot be stolen. Network nodes accept the first found block. And the problem is difficult. There is no guaranteed bound to find another block. When what happens when two nodes concurrently mine a block? And that is where you get into the fork. And that is where there is a possibility of a double spending. And now here you have to see if there are only honest nodes, what is the probability that can happen, kind of a framework or the other. I will not go into the probability of that is how in 1 hour, in 10 minutes, the blocks are added. So in 1 hour, you have six blocks added, and now you can say that becomes the bound in which you can say this transaction is more or less complete kind of a framework or the other. And so there are lots of things. So coming to the limitations, you have a high transaction confirmation latency, probabilistic consistency guarantees. You have a very low transactions per second of about 3 to 7 transactions per second. New block is added every 10 minutes. And now the challenge is how to scale Bitcoins. And of course, two obvious options throughout: increase the size of the blocks or decrease the block interval. Why they don't work? It decreases the fairness, giving large miners an advantage. Requires more storage space and verification time, and leads to higher number of forks kind of a framework. So there are many alternatives, what is called Bitcoin NG, BusyCoin, Elastico, Algorand, etc. I will not go into. There is a lot of applications coming into the picture. Like if you see long about in 2016, it was in the cusp. It was a very, very sought after technology. Now if you see in 2018, it has already reached and coming back to the application side kind of a framework or the other. The three most important properties are immutable, distributed, and public. If because it is immutable, nobody can change it. Because it is distributed, it is useful for public because anyone can verify. If all the loans are public, you cannot say this loan has been not discharged or given kind of a framework. And so that's how it becomes public kind of a framework. And so having no trusted party, now what is the thing you have achieved? You have obtained the trust from untrusted parties. Of course, you are believing on the mathematics, you are believing on the technology, and believing on the hardware. Otherwise, you have received a trust among all the others, and now you can say that I don't depend upon a government or a reserve bank to issue this, and now I can say this is the currency that has been issued kind of a framework. What are the issues, etc.? I will not go into the details kind of a framework or the other. So just to give you a long notion, a smart contract is the forerunner. What is the reason? In the digital India, if I have a land record, all the paper contract has to be translated into digital world. So now let us take a very simple example to see what is the challenge. A hypothetical digital security system for automobiles. The smart contract design strategy would be, that means it's a program. It has to become a program. Whatever is in the program, in the paper, has to become a program. So successively refine security protocols to be more fully embedded in a property, the contractual terms which deal with it. These protocols, like in the digital cash, there is a contract between the government and the issuer to say that if you tender this, you will get this. If you tender this 500, you are eligible for 500 rupees, etc. These protocols would give control of the cryptographic keys for operating the property to the person who rightfully owns that property based on the terms of the contract. If I have taken a loan on an automobile, now every month it has to be a deducted kind of a framework or the other automatically kind of a framework. The moment the money goes there, it has to be frozen. That means that the motorbike or the automobile will not work the kind of a framework. But what if it is going on a highway at a speed of 100 kilometers per hour? If it stops, then there will be a crash. Now you have to see how this can be avoided to say that now it can go till it stops in a safe place, and then only it will not go, etc. kind of a framework. That means that if you have a paper contract, how to transform it into digital contract is a very challenging task kind of a framework. It is non-trivial. Sometimes it may not be possible very easily, and unless you have some kind of a trusted party or something like that kind of a framework or the other. To conclude, I have some typical blockchain applications. It is not just, it has entered into a lot of things: legal, supply chain, government, energy, retail, and food, healthcare, insurance, travel, and hospitality kind of a framework. One of the wide things what has been used for foreign remittances, for example, in the Ripple, I can send money from India to US or US to India, and then it goes in a few minutes kind of a framework or the other. The other one is the supply chain. which is very clear kind of a framework, you are able to track down like what you see in the DHL or the Blue Dart kind of a framework or the other. And it is similarly being used for agricultural and the secure contract negotiation, healthcare and land management, etc. kind of a framework or the other. And so to conclude, the blockchain characteristics, distributed and resilient database, transparent to all participants, read by all, written by a few upon consensus, a continuous auditability, that means that you can go on auditing it, and you can have trade-off between very a blockchain properties kind of a framework. There are many challenges, choice of the platform, interoperability of the blockchains, privacy of the data on the blockchain, and automatic rule transformation into smart contracts, and data veracity like land records. If there is something, a landslide happens, what is the way that is going to happen, and now I have to keep track of it. And the governance rules have to be transformed into smart contracts, and this is the challenge for Digital India. And thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. You wind it up within 55 minutes itself. So we have now around 10 to 12 minutes to take up certain questions. I'll take up those questions one by one.
Yeah.
So the first one is, why cryptocurrency is banned in India? Because most countries like US, they have the cryptocurrency as a legal one.
Yeah,
and you know, what is the future of this cryptocurrency in developing countries?
See, cryptocurrency in lieu of fiat currency, the classic currency is called the fiat currency, is a difficult issue because there are so many issues that is coming into the picture. Where it can actually be used inside the bank, so that everything can become transparent based upon the properties kind of a framework or the other. For example, if a Gulf person wants to transfer money to India, it will take few days and he will not be able to send it with a lot of charge. Now, if I use this technology, which is the one which is used by Ripple, like Swift, etc., they take a lot of time or the other, within a few minutes, within which the volatility of the cryptocurrency is not enormous, is very little. So now the money goes and then he gets the money in the same thing or the other. Whereas to replace a fiat currency, it will have an impact of currency when the whole thing goes down for some reason or the other, it becomes difficult kind of a framework or the other. So fiat currency is being replaced by a cryptocurrency is a different aspect or the other, but it can certainly be used for varieties of things internally rather than publicly as a replacement of a currency kind of a framework.
Okay, sir. I'll take up the next one. Mm-hmm. How to protect from hackers as network is not in our hand?
So, you know, as far as the cryptocurrencies is concerned, the hacking, etc., does not, because it is distributed. If it has to happen, it won't all have ledgers. So, in some sense, that is where one hacking will not do that kind of a thing. But, you know, in maths we believe, in code we believe, these are the two slogans you have to believe at some point. If you have done a wrong coding, then the whole thing becomes wrong kind of a framework or the other. But hacking, is you can avoid it without much problem, without much impact on the whole network itself kind of a framework. Of course, if you forget about the whole secret key, there is no way you will be able to get it. And some people have lost lots of bitcoins.
Okay. So there is another one. How is blockchain distributed ledger different from a traditional ledger?
No, in the traditional ledger, it is not available publicly. Like let us say bank A or bank B, it has its ledger. The transactions between A and B are completely private to them. In this case, what happens, each ledger, what they do, it is public. That means anyone can look at it and then see, and the identity of that is identified by the public key kind of a framework or the other. You are mimicking the ledger in a transparent manner. So because technically bank are one place to another place, you cannot go on replacing all the a paper register with everyone, it becomes very difficult to check. Now if it is in an electronic form, if it is public, and now you can see how you can check it, and you can always make it private to say who can access it, who cannot access it, and there is no possibility of being it is immutable because nobody can change it. Whereas the disadvantage in the classic register is, what happens if he replaces one page by some means or the other of the whole register itself, if he replaces it kind of a framework, and that is the problem. That is the.
Okay, sir. So the next one is related to Bitcoin prices. So why are Bitcoin prices fluctuating? And is any money having a money value in terms of Bitcoins or cryptocurrencies?
No, you know, there is a limited, I think, 21 million, etc. That is the total number of Bitcoins that can exist in the whole system, which will become, it will reach an equilibrium state kind of a framework. It is almost like a shares. Suppose you consider that as a TCS shares or something of that nature. And now, as it becomes due to varieties of reasons, it goes on changing. There is no intrinsic way in which it is going to change. If I know that if this is the value I have, and now you can do it kind of a framework. There is no technical reasons one can say this, because as the system becomes not possible and people can put money, somebody is caught because he is using it for somebody purpose, then it may go down. And now all of a sudden, because somebody else is investing or buying, it may go up. And so these are the reasons for which there are no technical reasons kind of a framework.
Okay, sir. Why blockchain needs tokens to operate?
I didn't get exactly the question.
I think the question is rather incomplete. I'll take up the next one.
Okay.
That is related to some quantum properties like key distribution or synchronization surely makes the blockchain more robust. What are the various trade-offs and limitations associated with these techniques?
See, the question is that, you know, we know that a quantum way of distributing the keys has its own advantage. You can achieve, like, what is the simplest way in the Bitcoin you are going to achieve privacy is having different public private key pairs. And so that means that now if I have that in terms of the quantum, naturally the privacy can be increased, because it is not private because everything is public, everything is distributed, and immutable is the question that is the Solace kind of a framework. So that means that if I have those things, privacy comes in a little simpler way, rather than if I have to make a private, I have to make lot more efforts and build chains in which what is private, what is not private, and that is how you have permissioned and permissionless blockchains, etc., etc., kind of a thing.
Okay, sir. So there is one small question related to one of the equations which you have used. That is fx raised to the power 1/3. So the person is asking, can't we use fx raised to the power 1/4? In reference to E?
No, you know, usually it has to be a prime number. So okay. The reason that 3 is that this, suppose this one is used for 100 rupee denomination. If I want to use it for 200 rupees, I will have to use another exponent, which is, let us say, 5. And if it is 1000 rupees, I can use the exponent kind of a thing is the one which gives you different denominations that could become what is the thing that exists kind of a thing.
Okay, so I'll take up the last question. I think that is why one of the faculty members is asking that, can you provide a reference for a good technical book or a survey paper and not of a cryptography book? I mean, to understand these things.
Yeah. No, there is a very nice book by Arvind Narayanan from Princeton University. It is available in a public, the Amazon also is available, which is a new version. His old version is available for free download from his website, Arvind Narayanan from Computer Science Department, Princeton University.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. We have kept the whole time. Within 1 hour, we have completed the whole session.
Yeah.
And I would like to thank you on behalf of the organization, that is the National Academy of Sciences India and Deen Dayal Upadhyay College, And before I end the session, any remarks from your side about the experience? I have seen that there are about 300 attendees who were there all throughout the session itself.
Okay. So,
and they have written a lot of good comments which are there pertaining to the lecture. But any concluding remarks from your side?
No, in a concluding, this is a very exciting thing, kind of a framework. The one of the reasons I could have given only the small part, but because the traversal from the electronic cash to the Bitcoin is the crux. Like, that also gives you a feature for all the, what are all the issues? Like, if you see the currency, that's also a contract between the government and the RBI, which prints the notes. Now, similarly, if I have all those contracts, what are all the challenges for which you need a sophisticated math, sophisticated technology, and then I have to have some trust on the hardware or the other things or the other. You see, this is where what is important. Trust can only be relocated. You cannot create it. So now, if I say I have obtained trust from untrusted persons, the question is that where has the trust gone? It has gone to the mathematics. We can say in maths we believe, in the code we believe, kind of a slogans we have to put it, and then the technology and the servers. More and more servers are used, it becomes a general server, so it becomes easy. Whereas if it is a special server, then that person will have you have to trust him, kind of a framework or the other. So that is where one has to understand trust can be located, and transforming a paper contract into a digital forum, you have to look at the properties, and if you don't satisfy those properties, people will not accept it. If people will not accept it, all these things will become a waste, kind of a framework or the other. And the blockchain, one of the good thing of these properties of immutability, distributed and public, is something which can be used in governance, and particularly for, let us say, graduate certificates. People in the when people go out to study, they ask you whether this is authenticated at all or not. If the government maintains this kind of a blockchain kind of a framework or the other, that university can just shoot a query to such a system and they will get the query back, rather than all this kind of a framework or the other.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. I request all the attendees to kindly do fill up the feedback form before leaving the session. And I invite all of you for tomorrow's session at 6 p.m. itself. Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you all the participants.
Thank you very much, sir. Okay.